Welcome to the Institute of Historical Research and the latest, the fourth of these six monthly seminars that we're running on the way people use and abuse the past. As many of you remember, I see many familiar faces here. We began the present series in October with some of the knotty issues raised by the controversy over the Rhodes statue in Oxford. We went on to discuss the nature and causes of historical change, the role of great leaders, and so on. And in the December seminar, we asked what the correct focus of history should be. Should it be the nation, the locality, the wider world, and should it be a short or a long durée, and so on. This evening, we're going to attempt to come to terms with one of the thorniest questions of all, it seems to me. Is there any way history can be said to repeat itself? What lessons can we learn from history? Are there lessons that we can learn from the past as we try to adapt to a better present and future? I'm always struck by the wise words of the great French historian Marc Bloch, who said, "Misunderstanding of the present is the inevitable consequence of ignorance of the past." But what kind of lessons can we learn? Could the past have worked out differently in any way? There's been quite a trend recently for what has come to be known as counterfactual history. I must say, before I left home today, I was watching the Donald Trump, and I did the word counterfactual did cross my mind. But you may have seen a great deal of strikingly controversial writings about counterfactual history by people like Neil Ferguson and Richard Evans. And I must say I was a bit of a pioneer in all this because something nearly 40 years ago I produced a book about some of the supposed ifs of history, which I was very honoured to find Richard Evans attacking in his most recent book on this. So can our understanding of the past help us to plan a better present and a better future? What kind of lessons, if any, can we in the here and now learn from studying the past? So let me introduce tonight's panel. I usually do this in alphabetical order, but I'm going to do, just to be perverse, going to reverse the order this evening. And begin with Lucy Riall. I think I first met you, Lucy, when you were giving a lecture at the National Gallery years ago about the Italian divisionists, wonderful painters towards the end of the 19th century, just before the spectacular revolution of the early 20th century, a different kind of art. And what particularly impressed me, I was trying to write something about Verdi at the time, and you saw these late 19th century painters very much in a long historical context, going back to the Risorgimento, Garibaldi, and so on. Lucy was, I think, at Birkbeck at the time and working on your book, Garibaldi, Invention of a Hero, a wonderful revisionist interpretation that shows how much of the heroism associated with Garibaldi and the Risorgimento was, in fact, subsequently invented during the rather darker days that followed unification, very often, to some extent, invented by Garibaldi himself. You've written big history, national history, but also thinking of the last seminar we had, local or micro history, about this little village, Bronte, right near Mount Etna, which was at one time owned by Nelson, when he wasn't with Lady Hamilton, I suppose, and was part of the Garibaldi story when the thousand Garibaldi were crossing over to the mainland. So Lucy Riall, who's now based in the, I never remember what it's actually called, the European University Institute of Florence. Did I get it right that time?
That's right.
And she's in fact nipping off straight back to Florence tomorrow, and we're very thrilled to have her with us tonight. Ian Mortimer, the end there. Ian is one of those rare souls, an independent historian with an impressive record that draws together both serious scholarship and wonderful literary ability. I suppose if I can label you in, and I don't like to do so, a kind of a medievalist, except every time I meet you, you've written about something that's getting more and more modern. I'm still waiting for your book on Victoriana, but I guess that's a few years away. He's written the lives of Edward III, famously, father of the nation, Henry IV, Henry V, and I suppose most famously a series which I love called Time Traveller's Guides. What it would be like if we could go back and find ourselves in 14th century England, Elizabethan times, the Restoration, which you've been working on recently, and I think not yet published, but should be soon.
The proofs are done.
The proofs are done. It will happen. And also, I mean, I think one of my favourites among Ian's books is a remarkable volume which he looks at the past 1,000 years, century by century, and asks the interesting question, when was there most change? We all say we're living in a time of unprecedented change, but I gather people always did century by century. And he documents that brilliantly in that book. He's also the author of a number of fascinating articles about the very nature of history and historiography. And under the name of James Forrester, which I think are actually your middle names, is also a very prolific author of historical novels. One way or another, Ian, the perfect panelist for a seminar about what we can learn and what we can't learn from history. Taylor Downing, one of our leading chroniclers of the 20th century, especially perhaps its great conflicts, and he's done so on two distinct platforms. First, through television documentaries. It must be, 35 years or so since you founded Flashback, your company that we associate you with. But Taylor's also written a succession of wonderful books, all of them immaculately researched, concerning not only the history he's helped to portray on screen, but also about the very process of portraying history on screen, the hazards and the fulfillments of doing so. You may know his book on that unforgettable TV series, The World of War, produced by Jeremy Isaacs with the Laurence Olivier commentary. I happened to be fiddling with the television a week or so ago, the Yesterday Channel, and there I watched 2 or 3 episodes. It's forever on our screens. And worthily so. Taylor's written on both world wars and on the Cold War, on scientists in war, on spies, code breakers, the weaponry of war, and recently on the appalling physical and psychological breakdown suffered particularly in the First World War, what we used to dismiss as shell shock. And just read Taylor on the subject and you're aroused, it was a great, great deal deeper than that. So what can we learn about the past from films, particularly those concerning war? Something I've no doubt we'll hear more about from Taylor shortly. Of all tonight's panelists, I guess Jeremy Black is the one I've known longest. I think when you and I first met Jeremy, you must have been in your mid-late 30s. You were at Durham. And I thought of you then as primarily expert on 18th century British history, military, naval history, British foreign policy, and so on, although with a wider remit than that suggests. Jeremy was already a highly prolific author. I remember him telling me his ambition at the time was to have authored 40 books by the time he turned 40. Today, I'm afraid Jeremy's got things completely out of kilter. He published, I think by now, well over 100 books. And I won't reveal your age, but it's an awful lot less than mine. Jeremy's been professor of history at Exeter these past 20 years or so, and he's indefatigable. He's written about the Grand Tour. I went to a recent lecture he gave about the Fire of London. He told me he'd never given that lecture before, but it was absolutely brilliant and thoroughly, thoroughly researched. He's written on the press, on cartography, famously, slavery, historical links between political power and the acquisition of knowledge. Who has knowledge has the power. Recently, books about the wars of the 20th century, a wonderful recent volume on the Holocaust, for example, and about the uses of history itself. And I think just a year or so ago, a study you labelled Other Pasts, Different Presents, Alternative Futures, all very germane to tonight's seminar. So that, ladies and gentlemen, is the panel. I'm going to ask each of them to talk for 10 minutes broadly defined. If you go up to 11 or 12, I'll permit it. If not, I will put off the microphone, shoot you, and dismiss you. We'll aim to wrap up. It's now 10 past 6-ish, 12 past 6. We'll aim to have a good half hour's worth of questions, hopefully from about 7 o'clock, thereabouts. And half past 7, again, loosely defined, we'll break up. There'll be an awful lot of drinks there, and you're not allowed to leave the room until they've all been consumed. At which point, Lawrence Goldman, the director of the Institute, and I will whisk the panelists off for dinner after you've had a chance to have a drink and to meet the panelists. So, what sort of lessons can we learn from history? Does it ever repeat itself? Could things have been different in the past? Let's hear what the panelists have to say, and I'm going to take them again in very random order. Taylor Downing, why don't you kick off for us and tell us your thoughts?
Someone's got to go first.
And remember to project.
I shall try.
You're always brilliant, Taylor.
Thank you very much, Daniel. I've been to a couple of these seminars before. They've always been hugely interesting and stimulating. I'm looking forward to the discussion afterwards, rather than hearing what I've got to say. But anyway. I'm not actually going to say very much about counterfactual television, other than that I find it a really very interesting way of trying to think one's way back into the options, the decisions, the choices that were facing people at any one point in time. It's so easy to overlay history with a sort of sense of hindsight. All historians struggle not to do that, of course, but it's very easy to slip into that. For instance, the first half of the year 1914, the first 7 months of the year 1914, so easy to see, so often depicted as sort of the end of an era of innocence, the end of a chapter that was soon to be taken over by the tsunami of August 1914 that swamped all of Europe with war. But of course, for people living through it, it wasn't like that at all. It was a period of immense struggle, challenges, arguments about workers' rights, women's rights, arguments about new science, about the new art, arguments about Ireland, arguments about all sorts of things that had nothing to do with what very few people had any sense was just over the horizon. A European war. Likewise, I suppose we could, historians might look back on 2016, last year, and say that you know, the whole year is sort of dominated, swamped by the referendum in this country, by the referendum debate and the decision to leave Europe, and that all factors all the year, you know, must be interpreted in that context, which of course it wasn't. And I think for all of us who remember the first 5 months of last year. So, you know, counterfactual is a good way, I think, of getting into asking what were other options, what were other choices that people made at any point of time. But I think others on the panel are far more qualified to talk about this than me, so I'm not going to spend any more of my 10 minutes pursuing this line particularly. I want to talk about another version of history and ask what truth is there and what lessons are there here. Because of course most people derive their view of the past not from the academy, not from reading monographs, historical books, studying history, not even from reading popular history books, which I can tell you is a relatively small market. Most people derive their view of the past, their understanding, their interpretation of the past from films and from television, and of course from historical literature as well. But again, I'm not an expert in this. Ian might have some things to say on that subject later. So I want to talk specifically about films, in fact specifically about war films, a subject that I write about quite a lot, to ask what lessons do they suggest and what do they convey about the past? Do they present a heroic view of the past where virtues like courage, honor, bravery, sacrifice are constantly elevated? Or do they present a jingoistic view of the past, simply an opportunity to say, didn't we do well? We were the winners. You know, we were on the right side, we were the good guys. So, do you get from war films this heroic view or a jingoistic view of the past? And of course, in part, you know, different movies at different times appeal to both qualities. It's often said that the golden age of war movies in Britain was from the late 40s through to the mid to late 1950s. Movies like The Cruel Sea, The Dam Busters, Reach for the Sky, Sink the Bismarck, these are the sort of classic British war films of the 15 years or so after the end of the war. Heroes like Richard Todd, Jack Hawkins, Kenneth Moore, brave, tough, people focused, able to go through a crisis, but very tight-lipped, often not very emotional. In that, very, very British in many ways. I think it's fair to say that these films celebrate British values of comradeship, of muddling through, of smiling and carrying on in the face of adversity, but helped to perpetuate a sense of victory, but ultimately contributed to complacency, to decline, to a sense that, look at our past, let's remember these 6 years when Britain had a heroic moment to play, and let's not face up to, let's not confront the challenges of a changing economic world in the 50s and 60s, in the early 60s. I mean, I suppose similar things could be said about the other side. I mean, German films at the time often celebrate comradeship, particularly the comradeship of U-boat crews, often celebrate the struggle against overwhelming odds in retreat. But of course the Germans, A, didn't have a good war, obviously, and also I think were so much in the front line of the Cold War that was already dividing Europe that they had very different sets of issues to think about. I think it was a very British phenomenon to celebrate in these heroic, jingoistic films Britain's great moment of the Second World War. It's true also that not all films of this era took this heroic viewpoint. Different views come across from different films. When the Day Well presents, absolutely turns British complacency upside down with some very unpleasant, violent, very un-British moments in domestic settings. The Captive Heart, the first of the prisoner of war films, a genre that becomes very popular through the 50s and the early 60s, right up to The Great Escape in 63, I think it was. The Captive Heart presents a very different view of military failure, of defeat, openly talks about the military and political failures that led to the retreat at Dunkirk. And of course, anti-war films aren't something recent. From sort of Catch 22 onwards, they go right back to at least All Quiet on the Western Front, made in 1930, following the story of disillusionment of a group of German schoolboys who join up and fight in the German army. But do more recent films have a different effect? Is there something about the realism of more recent war films that perhaps presents a different view of war and different lessons from the past? I mean, in the 50s and 60s, this classic period that I'm talking about, death in a war film usually meant a stuntman throwing his hands up in the air, falling down dead. That was what death looked like in the classic films of the 50s and 60s. Today, of course, it's body parts splattered all over the screen, far more realistic. Does that then produce a different lesson from history, a more anti-war message, a different way of confronting the past? Well, possibly, but probably the most realistic scene in any war film of recent years is the opening scenes of Saving Private Ryan, Spielberg's famous 1998 film. I'm sure most of you here have seen it, the opening scenes of the Omaha landings on the morning of 6th of June 1944 are presented with an extraordinary sense of realism. It's often said, or it was often written at the time when it came out, that veterans from Omaha actually couldn't face watching up to these scenes. It sort of brought back a sense of trauma from that morning in a very powerful way. So does this give a different lesson from the past? Do we conclude from more modern war films that in fact war is dreadful, that we must never be complacent about the past? Maybe. But then even this film, even Saving Private Ryan, has been criticized by many people for praising American praising American military values. It helped to build support and to win approval for Bush's wars in Iraq from 2003 onwards amongst the American people. If you believe that view, Oliver Stone has argued that very firmly, for instance, Saving Private Ryan actually created a climate that supported the fighting of wars from 2003 onwards. If you believe that, then maybe war films can have a real effect on political consciousness. Of course, films and television programs all reflect the time at which they're produced. One of the most famous of the early television history series was Victory at Sea, made by NBC in 1952-1953. It's a 26-part series, very gung-ho, music by Richard Rodgers, the Rodgers of Hammerstein, a very bullish commentary. It's actually produced by NBC very clearly, with a very clear message. At the time of the Korean War, when the American military were facing a series of defeats, disasters, humiliations, retreats. And the series was made with a very positive intention of restoring American belief in military and naval values. It was a very heroic vision of World War II that Victory at Sea evoked. Very different to, Daniel mentioned earlier, the World at War, very different to the view from the mid-70s that comes out in a television series like The World at War, another 26-part series made by Thames Television. This definitely was not a series about heroism and courage. The courage in The World at War is the courage of civilians in the East End of London, the housewives in Leningrad, civilians in Tokyo and other cities bombed by the Americans in Japan. These are the heroes of the World at War. There were no winners and no losers in the World at War. It's a far more nuanced view of the war, stressing the moral equivalence of combat, whether you're in the German army, the Russian army, the American army, or the British army. There's an equivalence in the World at War that's quite different view of warfare from the early 70s to that of the early 50s. So, you know, where does that take us? Well, obviously, there are many mixed messages that come from film and television. Hardly surprising, bearing in mind the range of different production contexts. And it's clear that very often, films, war television documentaries, war programs, war series, tell us more about the time they were made than actually the time they depict, the time they're made about. When I started studying history, historians had to struggle for film to be accepted as evidence. And mostly historians were concerned with newsreels, with documentaries, with the sort of depiction of factual information, and how newsreels compared to newspapers, and how factual information was disseminated, and so on. Now, with the wider availability of audiovisual resources, film, and to a degree television, is much more studied within the history of culture. And I think this is definitely where war films and TV programs as a historical source should be located. Two final quick references. In Which We Serve, Noel Coward's fabulous 1942 telling of the story of HMS Kelly of Mountbatten, the captain of HMS Kelly, presents a perfect picture of the British at war. Everyone knows their place in a strict hierarchy, and everyone is devoted to the greater good. Compare that from the 1940s to, say, Catherine Bigelow's The Hurt Locker, released in 2010, a film about bomb disposal squad in Iraq. Very gritty, dealing with how men can be utterly addicted, like a drug, to war. A very contemporary take on the experience of war, very different. So for me, film and television, it can become an important historical source. It's problematic, it's complicated production process. The French believe in the auteur, one person is the author of a film. Personally, I've never believed very strongly in that. Film and TV is a collaborative process requiring a lot of different skills to come together, and also the decisions to commission and to make programs coming from executives who rarely have a particular interest in the artistic world in which they're operating in, but looking at the sort of cash returns and so on. So the making of films and television is a complicated process that I think historians need to to understand something of. And then, of course, how they're received is also very different, very difficult to assess. You can't just go on audience figures or audience returns. Mass Observation used to do wonderful work in the Second World War, having people in cinemas noting how people responded to certain scenes. They would have a sort of scene list beforehand, but a note 1 to 10 of how people responded to these scenes. Enormously interesting, because actually we don't really know, in lots of cases, we can write about films, we don't really know how people reacted to them. They often noted that a shot of Mussolini would come up and people would boo, and then a shot of Churchill would come up and people would cheer. But sometimes they noted that Mussolini came up and people cheered. Churchill, shot of Churchill came up and people booed. Very interesting to sort of hear that the audience isn't always one sort of united group, as we might think it is. So they're a source that tells us about the thinking and the mindset of those who made them and those who saw them. In 1955, when the Ealing Studios were sold, the legendary studio chief, Michael Bulkan, put up a plaque that read, "Here, during a quarter of a century, many films were made projecting Britain and the British character." And I think that's what makes films an interesting aspect and an important source of 20th century history.
Thank you, Taylor. And I'm now going to ask Lucy Riall to speak, and she's got an image.
Yeah.
I could put the lights down, but I'm not sure whether I'll succeed. I'm not sure I'll succeed in putting them up again. So let's have a look.
Thank you very, very much. So I'm going to start with this image. It's a 1937 drawing by George Gross, entitled Spain, and it's from the Museo Reina Sofia in Madrid. It's part of the rooms that surround the Guernica. Now the subject matter, I think, probably needs no explanation. It's fairly clear. It's about the arrest, it's about an arrest taking place. But it's actually the dedication that's interesting. Now I've enhanced the writing so that you can see it, but the dedication reads, apparently from 1940, so where the drawing was from 1937, the dedication is from 1940, and it says, "To Betty and Bernard, with Xmas wishes and hope for a better year, 1941, George." Okay, let me just put that back in the picture. And now, this dedication would be interesting at the best of times. In the year 2016, when I first saw it, it was positively disturbing. How could anyone, we ask ourselves, in 1940, have possibly dared to hope that 1941 would be better than 1940? But this is seemingly what George Gross did. And so I think there are a number of ways of responding to this new 1941 New Year greeting by George Gross. First of all, actually as asked by Dan, we could engage in, it could be a kind of a provocation to us to engage in counterfactual history by asking ourselves how George Gross's hopes for a better 1941 might actually have been realised. What factors might have changed everything for Europe in that year? So we could ask ourselves, what if France had been better prepared for war in 1914 and hadn't fallen? What if during the Battle of Britain the Spitfire had proven less effective as a fighting machine? What, we could also ask, if Hitler had been a bit more sensible and hadn't invaded the Soviet Union? The point of these counterfactuals is that they're useful because they enable us to isolate and analyze the role of, in the case of the Spitfire, the role of technology. In the case of the fall of France, the role of political stability and political institutions. And in the case of Hitler's invasion of the Soviet Union, the role of personality in violence and warfare. So we can actually look at what would have happened if that element had not been present. Equally, actually, which is where I have to confess, particularly enjoy counterfactual history, is it can provide the basis for novels. And a great number of novels, particularly 20th century novels, play around with the idea of what might have happened if a particular element hadn't been present in the 20th century, and explores a possible different world. And I think that's actually a very clever, actually a really quite fascinating narrative device. Alternatively, we can not engage in counterfactual history, and we can borrow from what social scientists, particularly political scientists and economists, call path dependency theory. How many of you know what path dependency theory is? It's actually quite interesting. It's something that, you know, if you're a historian, you laugh about. Because path dependency theory, in its most basic form, is basically history. It's just that economists and political science can't call it history, so they have to call it path dependency theory. But basically, it sees, in a basic form, it actually does, there are, particularly for in economics, it actually does have some very interesting, it's an interesting methodology. But in this case, and using its more basic form, we could see the course of events that George Grotz was living through as a number of almost unstoppable reactive sequences, or a number of unstoppable reactive events determined by a primary event, in this case perhaps the Spanish Civil War that George Grotz is depicting there. So we could say actually that it's his hopes for a better 1941 were absurd, were ridiculous, were certainly in vain, because it couldn't have been any other way because of the sequence of events that had been unleashed by, say, Spanish Civil War. But actually, I was looking at this and I was thinking to myself, why is it fascinating me so much as drawing, and particularly the dedication, and it's not just to do with 2016, looking at 2017, although obviously that does kind of bring it home in a very stark way. I want to actually learn something else from his New Year's greetings. And that is perhaps the greatest lesson that the past can really teach us, is that people didn't know what was going to happen next. What with hindsight seems completely obvious, that 1941 was going to be a lot worse than 1940, was not necessarily obvious at the time. Now, this is relatively straightforward, but it's actually the reasons why it wasn't obvious at the time that I think are also revealing. In this particular case, Grotz, for very obvious reasons to do with his own life and his own family and his own political and artistic sensibilities, may simply not have wanted to see what was coming. He hoped, as he said, it would not happen. And this is a powerful motivation, if you like, clouding people's judgment, clouding or affecting or constraining their analysis of what is going on, and indeed of what has even happened in the past. Others, of course, the Nazis and the fascists, may have been absolutely delighted by what happened in 1940. So that context and perspective, the perspective of the standpoint of the observer in 1940, was actually everything, as it still is today. So when we think for a moment of Marx's aphorism that you will doubtless all know, written about the advent of power, the seizure of power of Napoleon III, and reflecting on the relationship between Napoleon III and his seizure of power in the early 1850s, and the relationship between Napoleon III and his uncle, the great Napoleon Bonaparte, Marx remarks, history does repeat itself, the first time as tragedy, the second time as farce. This probably right now, right here, right now, has never seemed more apposite. Never seemed more alarming or more true. But we might do well, as historians, or those interested in history, to remind ourselves that not only do we not know what is going to happen in 2017, but also that people in the past didn't know what was going to happen either. So that Marx wasn't really drawing lessons from the past, or he wasn't only drawing lessons from the past. He was making a very good guess and he was turning a very clever phrase. However, it's not that easy, of course. The idea of observable patterns in the past, the idea that there are discoverable templates from the past for how events unfold, this is a very appealing idea. And it actually is, at least in part, and it always has been, one of the justifications for the study of history. Certainly in the 20th century, it was really one of the reasons why history starts to posit itself as a social science, at the same level as economics and political science and sociology. It's to do with it, in a sense, it's our ability to learn lessons from it and to predict, arguably, even the future. I would actually go further still and say that it's precisely these days what makes many people irritated by historians, is that they actually refuse to draw lessons from the past. And if they're asked to explain a lesson from the past, what they will almost invariably respond in one way or another is to say, well, it's complicated. Which of course, if you're a historian, obvious and clear, but if you're not a historian and you want to learn something from a historian, actually very annoying, can be very annoying. So can we do anything more? Can we do anything more than say, well, yeah, I guess there are some lessons to be learned from the past, but you know, it's complicated. Can we do anything more than this? Well, I think we can, actually, partly because of the popularity of history and because of the general public's engagement with history. And I've always thought, and always sort of said, again, when I teach, that history has a great advantage, certainly over its neighbours, if you like, in the social science, and it uses ordinary vernacular language, and it makes it more accessible than other disciplines. And that actually historians do have to engage with this popularity, in fact, as you've been saying about the lessons from wars. Because part of the popularity of history is connected, it seems to me, to a desire to compare the present to the past, or compare the past to the present and to take lessons from the past. I was having a little look through newspapers in preparation for today, and I came up with a few questions that seem to have been around lately. First of all, most amusingly, because I don't really understand it, and I have it again. Is Theresa May like Henry VIII, like King VIII? Does Donald Trump have political other antecedents in Silvio Berlusconi or Benito Mussolini? Actually, very interesting one, which has been in the newspaper, I think, last week. Can Great Britain learn anything from the British Empire, study the British Empire, learn anything from Germany's attempt to confront its violent colonial past? And a few years prior to this, can the failure of appeasement in the 1930s justify the war on terror? And I think that in all these cases, historians can help. To the Theresa May question, I think historians can say no. Although they might, and this is important, they might ask the question, why are people asking that question at all? What does that, why the comparison with Henry? What is that question telling us about the way in which politics are developing? They might answer, Donald Trump probably does have antecedents in Silvio Berlusconi, although the context is very different. And although Donald Trump may not even have heard of Benito Mussolini, he is in fact influenced by him through the political style adopted by Berlusconi, because Berlusconi borrows from Mussolini and Donald Trump borrows from Berlusconi. Germany's attempt to confront its colonial past could indeed teach us all something in this country. However, having said that, we should be aware of the very specific in political and emotional charge associated with the word genocide in present-day Germany. And as we know, I don't know whether any of you read it, I think it was in The Independent, back before the Second Gulf War, a series of historians did debate whether or not appeasement was a model, was an appropriate model for what was happening after 9/11 and whether or not it could, in some sense, be used as a justification for the war in Iraq. So to be clear, and to sort of try to bring it to close, what I'm trying to see is that I think this is goes beyond saying it's complicated when asked whether there are lessons to be learned from the past, but actually asserting, or indeed demonstrating by explaining and seeking to understand the importance of complexity. The present, in other words, again something that Daniel said, the present is complicated because the past was complicated. That's a lesson that historians, I think, can teach. And that what the past teaches us is complexity, rather than any lessons, patterns, or templates that might enable us to control the present. Because ultimately, that is the kind of ambition behind all of this. Lessons from the past in order that we might better be able to control the present. To conclude, we may all be, I am actually anyway, we may all be very tired by now of being told we live in a post-truth world created by the internet and by a new breed of politician that follows a different set of rules. I think that history teaches us also that we've always lived in a post-truth world. This is not only because there are antecedents for post-truth politicians. Couple of nice examples, I think. 19th century nationalists used the birth of a mass press in the middle of the 19th century to argue that nations existed when they didn't. Nazis used radio and film and the new mass media to spread their message that Jews were the source of all the problems of the world. So that's the kind of post-truth world that I'm talking about. If half lie, and what history also tells us, is that if half lies or outright falsehoods are repeated often enough and in a seductive enough fashion, many people may come to believe that they're true. There's nothing new about that. In the construction, finally, of these falsehoods as truth, it seems crucial for us to recognize that the past has a vital role to play. The past can be called upon to legitimate the claims of the nation. The past appears to ground the claims of the nation that they always existed. The past can be appealed to justify, or again, to legitimate the false, obviously, accusation that Jews have always been the enemy. So it's this, in my view, it's the false lesson from history that it is the task of historians to address. And it seems to me that this is the task of the historian, now more than ever, to challenge this false view of history and the distortion of the past for political means. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much indeed. Fascinating talk. Let me call upon Ian Mortimer, would you like to come and join us, Ian, and take things further.
Thank you, Daniel. I've been quite prosaic in the way I've approached this by just looking at your three questions and thinking of answers to them. Straight as that. But of course, as is the way with being at least third here, you realise that your predecessors I've already been beaten to it by two people already. I was asked the question, does history repeat itself, quite a lot the year before last when Centuries of Change was published and I was going around promoting it. And I came up with this analogy to explain very simply the whole question, does the past repeat itself? And simply think of an ocean wave. If you look at waves, I live in Devon, so I live with a lot of waves. If you look at waves, they all look the same. If you could look at any one of them, they are all different. We all know that. And that is quite a good analogy for this question of does the past repeat itself or not. Because if you're going to be academic and strict, no, it never does. But if you're going to stick to that throughout, you're never going to learn anything from the patterns of the past. And you are, in this context, redundant as a historian, because you can't say anything about the future or about the meaning of the past for mankind today. So there's a spectrum. There's an academic, refined, precise spectrum with which the past does not repeat itself. Every detail and context is always different. And then there's the other end of that spectrum, which is we're going to learn something in general, we're going to work with a degree of superficiality, and we're going to say something about mankind based on some of these repetitions. And there, of course, lies a huge danger, because what lessons can you learn from the past becomes a matter of selection. Imagine, well, I'm going to take two ad absurdum examples from the Middle Ages to show you what I'm talking about here. Black Death. What lessons could you learn from the Black Death? Well, one of the valuable lessons I often repeat is that you have what is undoubtedly the worst calamity that's affected mankind for the last 2,000 years, and society didn't fall apart. Every time you see on television a terrible infection or something like that, wiping out huge numbers of the population, law and order breaks down. In the 14th century, on the whole, law and order did not break down. There were some isolated cases, and Florence is one, where there was a breakdown of law and order temporarily. But pretty much it's true that when an absolutely cataclysmic event comes along, people buckle, or get together, they buckle under, they accept orders, and society does not collapse into disorder. There's one good lesson you could learn from. And because this is an absurd example, I'm going to say, well, also, historians will tell you that nothing freed up the social stricture of the Middle Ages as much as the Black Death. It broke so many prejudices, so many conventions, so many restrictions in the way people behaved, that you could say nothing really reallocated opportunity and reallocated wealth as much as the Black Death. From which, if you were cynical, you could say if we really want to have a social revolution, we'll have large numbers of people. Now, I'm not advocating that you do that. Take another 14th century example where you might take a wrong lesson from history. I'm thinking about somebody I've written about, Edward III, who himself learned from history. In 1326, he was given a treatise by Walter de Milmeat in which he was exhorted to stop his magnates from warring amongst themselves. That is the worst thing that could happen to England. That he should allow to happen to England what his father had allowed to happen. Then a second. Edward III took this very seriously, and he kept England united by having a continual war with France, and pretty much into the war with Scotland. Now, if you apply this whole philosophy to the 20th century, that you will keep your nation united and all working to one cause by warring with your enemy, you can see it's not perhaps the best lesson to take from the 14th century. And although that is an example, we do have to remember that we're looking back at the past. For most of our written heritage, war has been celebrated, and warriors have been celebrated, and generals have been celebrated, and war has generally been seen in many contexts as a good thing. So we have a real danger. We have two sorts of dangers, really. The dangers are the lessons the public claims to learn from history, and the lessons we as historians, hopefully responsible people, wish to teach about the past. And just to give a little refinement to the first of those, the lessons people learn or people want to teach themselves from the past, I've noticed that when people start quoting the past and the lessons we can learn from it, it tends to be very much confirmation bias. Just in case you don't know what I mean by that phrase, there's a really good little analogy on the radio the other day. If you believe that immigrants in this country are responsible for most of the bad things happening, every time you hear that an immigrant has committed a crime, you'll see that as further confirmation of what you already believe. And this is the real danger the lessons we learn from the past is that the public as a whole simply confirms, uses the past to confirm its prejudices. And that really isn't learning from the past. But it also makes it very, very difficult for historians to agree and say what we should learn from the past. I've really sort of thought about three things, not just because they could be taught, but because pretty much I talk about them quite a lot of the time. The first one, the first lesson I would say that historians should really teach, and I try to teach as much as possible, is that life, the way we live today, isn't normal. We are living in one of the most luxurious, privileged bubbles there could possibly be in terms of energy and food and everything like this. The Time Traveller's Guides really do highlight hardship because I want people to realise how lucky they are living in the early 21st century. If you were living in the 14th century, life was so much harder. And the reason for the immediacy of those books is to bring home to people how lucky they are. And history, I think, has a responsibility to show you the way we live today isn't simply normal and to be taken for granted. A second area where I think historians should teach lessons from the past is to make people aware of danger, to encourage caution. It doesn't necessarily lead you to the right answer, but to encourage caution in the way we look at the world unfolding around us. And to get an idea of this across, I just want to give you one little anecdote, which is my daughter's 16th birthday yesterday. My daughter is allergic to history. She's grown up in a house which is medieval with 5,000 history books crammed in there, and she just doesn't want to hear any more about it. But 4 years ago, we had a wonderful experience together when, in reading her bedtime stories, that I was still doing when she was 12, I read her The Diary of Anne Frank. Now, Anne Frank's story is, Anne Frank never lived to 16, of course, is a remarkably powerful way of showing how even innocent people can be the victims of the most atrocious regimes which have been voted into power. And that little example shows how we can learn so much about the dangers that could beset us, that are all around us, from the past. The third area I think we have lessons to learn from the past is simply being aware that it was there. I've worn this tie today because I've, for the last 14 years, been a Secretary of State member of Dartmoor National Park Authority, and I chair the something called the Working Panel on Planning and Sustainable Development. Sustainable development in a national park is an oxymoron. It is really difficult to get across to my fellow members. There are 19 of us who run the national park. It is really difficult to get across to them that change carries on happening after the decisions you make today. For example, we are required under current legislation to have a local plan which designates large areas of national park for development, residential development. We can't get away from this now. It is a requirement. We wouldn't get through a judicial review if we didn't have this all set up. So, although our whole purpose is to conserve and enhance, we also have a legal requirement to destroy quite a lot of what we're supposed to be conserving. And when I'm trying to get this across to county councillors, to the officers of the National Park, to people who want to develop, obviously, district councillors, and they say, but 1-2% per year is quite acceptable. But 1% growth of a community per year means an additional 170% over the course of a century. Now, in national park terms, just to give you a few figures, that's 2,577 hectares becoming 6,498 hectares. That's all going to come from farmland. We're detracting our amenity. We're detracting from our farmland, our resources, and producing more and more unproductive land. Getting that message across to people is very difficult. And when you start talking about 2%, you're looking at 624% increase over the course of 100 years. And why are we only looking at 100 years? A national park is for the nation forever. It's not just for 100 years or 200 years. To safeguard things, and of course, by analogy, I don't mean just national parks, I mean the whole country. To safeguard things, we must keep a view on time and plan accordingly. I'm just going to end with one other point in that Taylor mentioned the literary side of things, and also mentioned a film in which we serve. I'm sure everybody here knows it. And in fact, it's a complete coincidence, but I was at my fiction publisher earlier. They showed me the cover of my new novel, which is called The Outcast of Time, in which a medieval character sells his soul to the devil, lives for 600 years, and goes to sea. In which we serve. As he lives until the year 1942. The point of the book, and the reason for adopting a fiction way of getting this message across, is that the message is something you can't easily do in non-fiction, but it is really important anyway, and it is a lesson we can learn from the past, we can all learn from the past, in that the little things we do today have bigger and bigger ramifications as the years go by. And if you think in terms of that decision of the Chinese government in 1980 was, but they're going to have the one-child policy. Well, when they were coming under pressure for not having any more coal-fired power stations, they were able to respond, but our one-child policy has stopped 350 million people being built. We have done more on the conservation of the planet front than you have through not having five coal power stations in Britain. And these incremental changes do add up. If you can stop so much consumption, so much development, you can conserve. Now, I think the key here is the key lesson that historians can teach people is to think in the long term. No one really is equipped to think about hundreds of years apart from historians. And if we can all make people think that way, we'll be getting somewhere. Thank you.
Jeremy Black to give us his thoughts. Over to you, Jeremy.
Thank you. Well, I wonder if I can be rude about my profession. I always am slightly worried when I hear the idea that the general public is prejudiced, but there's this priesthood of academics that somehow knows the answers and is best placed to mediate on the past. It troubles me, that view. So let me start by offering a few counterintuitive ideas. Maybe some of them will be offensive, maybe deliberately offensive. Let's start off. Academic history is marginal to the way in which we look at the past. Most people look at the past within very different contexts. Their family, their immediate community, a group that we've never mentioned once so far this evening, religion. I mean, I'm an atheist, but in practical terms, if you think about the lessons of the past, the lessons that are driven home every Friday if you're a Muslim, every Sunday if you're a Christian, are lessons directly from texts of the past, which are still supposed to have a living validity. I mean, it's obviously, as you'll be aware, academics never talk about that sort of thing because they live in a secular world or a secular self-regarding world in which they don't think these terms have any meaning. So I want to try and be a little bit more questioning about them. I want to divide my comments into two parts. First of all, I want to look at the question we've been asked about, are there lessons we can learn from the past, and does the past repeat itself? That's number one. And then I want to look at this counterfactual one. So let's start with, are there lessons we can learn from the past? Whether we think there are lessons or not, people actually argue that there are. It is a rhetorical device as much as anything else. Academics take part in rhetorical devices. They so happen to value their rhetorical devices and are rude about other people's rhetorical devices. But if we put that to one side, rhetorical devices argue that you learn from the past because that's the nature of experience, and it's the way you project yourself into a vision of the future and propose policy. Obviously, therefore, people will argue that they learn from the past, and obviously, since they have to coin their experience in order to understand where they are in the present, they do learn from the past. Whether or not we choose to agree with their process of learning is another question. And linked to that, of course, is this issue which Daniel's asking, is does the past repeat itself? Well, again, as Ian will tell you, there are different cultural bases to the notion of how time operates. Very simply, and we can complicate this, but it's late in the evening. Very simply, there are cyclical notions of time, and there are progressivist notions of time. Cyclical notions of time focus on the idea that the past does repeat itself, as in some respects it obviously does. The day comes round, there is a diurnal pattern of repetition, there is an annual pattern of repetition, there clearly are patterns of repetition. The question is how far we can progress with those patterns of repetition. And of course the notion of cyclical change in history, if we just look at those developed societies that I'm going to talk about, there are many other societies and this in no way is comprehensive, cyclical notions of history, of the rise and fall of human societies, generally at the behest of providential forces, is the major way in which the past was thought about across most of the past. Now, that's a beautifully ambivalent phrase which gets us out of the question of when did providential interpretations of history end. And in fact, as you may know, that there is more argument of late that providentialism went on being very, very important, certainly into 19th century Western thought. It probably is important now, though I doubt that very many academics think about it. So there is the notion of providential intervention in cyclical patterns, the rise and fall of empires, the sort of things that academics of the past got interested in if they lived in that world, or intellectuals of the past. There is a Gibbonian emphasis of that. Gibbon's writing about the rise and fall of the Roman Empire was interesting to contemporaries because it came out between 1776 and 1788 at a time when contemporaries thought maybe the same thing is happening to the British Empire, but also because that notion of rise and fall meant something. Now, clearly, that idea of the past as one that sustains itself through a cyclical pattern enforced by some form of providential destiny has become less persuasive in ideologies that are self-consciously secularist, whether those ideologies are of the left, sort of Marxist ideologies, or whether those ideologies are of the right. And indeed, insofar as we are looking at the very basic level of environmental change or demographic change, it's rather difficult to think in a world in which we've got nearly 8 billion people at the moment, and rising possibly by the end of the century to over 10 billion people, it's rather difficult to think that the past can actually repeat itself when the past might be a matter of the world having half a billion. But, you know, there are differences of opinion on this, and, you know, Ian may have some very interesting views on that, because there were, of course, demographic downturns in the medieval period. But that's something that one can consider. So that's this notion, do we learn from the past? Does it repeat itself? People clearly learn from the past because that's how they construct their experience. Does it repeat itself? It depends what level you're talking about. The most basic of levels, I hope I'm not shocking everybody here, we are all going to die. The past is obviously going to repeat itself. We will become past. You know, there is a fantasy out there that in some way we can, our experience can exceed that of our predecessors. It's one one's got to be very careful about. Linked to that, this notion of lessons, of course, part of it is the question of how you choose to present the past. And there's a multiplicity of ways. I said to Taylor, I say something awkward about D-Day. And let's just, for example, the film, that, as he said, Saving Private Ryan, it's a very vivid account of what it's like to be machine-gunned if you're in the water. Okay, that is pretty much what it's like to be machine-gunned if you're in the water. It doesn't really tell you very much about Omaha in the broadest perspective, which is that for fewer than 10,000 casualties, the Allies overcame the fortified defences on five beaches and got over 150,000 men across on one day, which is actually an amazing military experience. People die. Well, that's what happens in war. What a surprise. So partly it is a question of what lessons you want to learn. If you want to learn the lesson that people die, well, then there's a lesson that is vividly presented to you. If you want to learn the lesson that actually, given that they hadn't managed to suppress the ferro-concrete defences by the air attack, and there's a very good scholarly study by Adrian Lewis as to why they got it wrong on Omaha, whereas the bombardment worked on the other beaches. If you want to learn that lesson, you're not going to learn it from Saving Private Ryan. You select the lesson you want to learn. But that is not a bad thing. It doesn't mean that the historian's lesson, I'm not a better person because I can set it in a broader context. And in fact, you might say I deliberately presented myself as an appalling shit because I don't care so much about the people that died. And I deliberately did that because you can turn around and say that your experience of history, what it must have meant like to suffer, is more important than mine presenting it in a broader context. And it's not that I'm right or you're right. These are different ways to look at a subject and different ways to interrogate the past. Now, and that doesn't mean we're in a post-truth society to say that we're in different ways. We're being mature. Okay? Now, let's just take that a stage further then with this question of counterfactualism. Counterfactualism, you know, there's been childish attacks on it by Richard Evans, who's just a pompous prat. But if you want to look, well, he is. He might be Regis Professor, he's a pompous prat. But if you want, I'm quite happy to say that to his face, I have done. If you want to take it a stage further, think of it in these terms. There are counterfactualisms that are valid and counterfactualisms that are problematic. Let's take a problematic one. The meteorite that drops into the western approaches on the night of the 5th to the 6th of June 1944, producing a tsunami that goes along the channel, destroying the invasion fleet. In the end, actually, the Germans still lose because you just dropped the first atom bomb on Berlin. But doesn't matter. That presents you with a counterfactual. Could it have happened? Well, of course it could have happened. A meteorite could have landed on the western. And the Western approaches, meteorites hit the world. But nobody at the time was thinking about it. So it's not really a terribly helpful counterfactual to use. But of course, most of the literature about counterfactuals isn't silly and isn't trivial. What the literature is, and this is what people like Evans ignore, what the literature does is it returns one to the state of uncertainty in which people engage with their own experience and engage with what they imagine that experience is going to lead to. Now that is important. There is, as you will probably know again though, that this is culturally constructed. Some societies are more willing to engage with counterfactualism than others. It's very interesting in this. I mean, if you look at the most counterfactual books have been produced in the Anglosphere. There are very few counterfactual books that have been produced in the Germanic lands. Doesn't mean that one lot is better than the other. It reflects the idea that there are ways in which you should look at the past and you should look at the experience between past and future. Now, to me, I actually find counterfactualism useful because what it does is underline the extent to which, as my colleagues have said, people did not know what is going to happen. Or let's put it a different way. They did know what was going to happen, it's just they had lots of different answers. In a sense, people imagined they knew exactly what was going to happen. It's often very rare, particularly if you go back to my period, the 18th century, everybody was confident they knew what was going to happen. It's just they had different answers. There is a Whig vision of the future, there is a Tory vision of the future, there is a vision of the future that might be held by certain diplomats, there's a vision of the future that might be held by certain generals. There are lots and lots and lots of visions of the future on offer, being asserted in quite clear rhetorical approaches. What is uneasy is to realise that in a sense, to make an assessment of them, you have to go back and look at why did they think this, and the only way to really effectively to do it is to play through the exercise that they laid out. So if you want to critique counterfactuals, what I would say is it's reasonable to ask the question, which is a difficult one, which is how valid is it to discuss a counterfactual that people at the time did not conceive of? And some of those might be much more plausible than your meteorite landing on the Western approaches. You know, new epidemics, for example, new plants, all sorts of proposals that you could bring up. But what is really, to my mind, important in when one is looking at counterfactuals is to return us to the uncertainty of the past. In doing so, we also understand our relationship with the future. My own view is, and this is, you know, everybody likes to pontificate if they're academics about what history is about. I actually think history is three things. I think it's both what happened in the past, how we provide accounts of what happened in the past, and they come from very varied backgrounds, and it's also this sense of a trust between the past, the present, and the future. The attempt in each generation to try and understand what happened in the past is in part a trust between the generations. It's in part based on a belief that people will do that to us in the future. So it's a characteristic that seems to be inherent to the species, or certainly the species insofar as we know about it from the position in which it started to produce texts. We do not necessarily think that the same characteristic is true of other species. So that itself is a very interesting way to look at this question. Is it the idea and capacity to imagine different pasts, different presents, and different futures, an aspect that we have learnt as a developing species? Where does it come from, and what does it tell us about us? Now, to me, that is an important way of looking at this very interesting question, or set of questions that Daniel has raised, and my knowledge of anthropology is rather limited, but I wonder whether somebody in the audience would be able to cast some light on that. Thank you very much.